Cramer's rule is a theorem, very beautiful mathematically, but quite useless computationally. So the formal solution for Ax equal to b is A inverse b, but there is a Cramer's rule which will give you each element of the solution x, which reads the determinant of Aj by determinant of A. So determinant of A comes in the denominator. Aj, I haven't defined what Aj is. Aj is a matrix, the same matrix as the coefficient matrix, but the jth column replaced by the constants vector. So it looks quite neat to write it that way, and it looks like a beautiful formula. But again, you have to compute n different determinants in the top and one more determinant in the bottom. Determinant computation is quite bad. It's not easy to do. Gauss Jordan elimination will give you this solution at least n times faster. But this is Cramer's rule. Mathematically, probably quite nice. Okay, that actually brings us to the end of the algebraic view. We started with the basic part, numerical computations. The first part was just defining linearity in linear algebra, what it means, and how that led to the concept of vectors, and why we came up with this table of numbers so that we could write systems of linear equations in a compact form. We did that. And then we talked about the operations on vectors and matrices, and how linearity actually manifested itself in the operations. And then we moved on to the definitions of transposes, determinants, and their properties. That kind of finished the first part. The second part was algebraic view. While the first part was 3 chapters, the second part was only 2 chapters, basically Gaussian elimination and Gauss Jordan elimination. Gaussian elimination plus back substitution is essentially Gauss Jordan elimination. And Gauss Jordan elimination can compute inverses, because by doing Gaussian elimination and back substitution, you're getting to the solution. The solution, as you know, is basically A inverse the constant vector B. So A inverse is there implicitly somewhere in Gauss Jordan, which is what we made explicit. We brought it out and we showed that that is actually Gauss Jordan on A augmented by I will give you the inverse. Now, in the algebraic view, we saw that the algebraic view was about solving equations. Gaussian elimination plus back substitution will give you the solution. Gauss Jordan elimination will give you the solution directly, which is not very different from Gaussian elimination from plus back substitution. Then if you have inverse, if A, the coefficient matrix, is full rank square, then you have an inverse, and then X can be written formally as A inverse B, or you could use Cramer's rule also. So 4 different ways of doing it. But remember, inverse and Cramer's rule will work only in the ideal situation. You have a unique solution and A is invertible, etc. They are also computationally expensive and apparently numerically not very stable either. So bad things to consider if you're doing it on a computer. So that kind of completed our algebraic view, which was about solving systems of linear equations. Now, while looking at the solutions of simple equations like x plus y equal to 5, x minus y equal to 1, we drew lines and looked at the intersection. That may have looked like geometry, but that's geometry in what we might call the coordinate space, the xy plane or xyz space or something like that. That's not the geometry of linear algebra that we will start next week, which will be the sophisticated view of linear algebra, matrices and solutions and everything. It's the basis of the next phase of our understanding of linear algebra. The coordinate space is a collection of points where you can have lines and planes and different curves, etc. The vector spaces that we will deal with in linear algebra are actually more primitive. They are just sets of vectors. So all you have in a vector space is a collection of vectors, nothing more. So you don't have lines and planes, etc. Those are all in coordinate space. So there's a different idea of spaces that we'll come up with. And to the extent possible, we will try to distinguish between these two in the following classes. At times, it might be interesting to think of vector spaces also as coordinate spaces. There'll be some overlap for one good reason that we will understand later. But theoretically, a vector space is a set of all possible vectors of a given dimension. That's the way we'll look at it starting next week. And in the vector spaces also, the equations will form some kind of geometry. Matrices also will form some kind of geometry. And the properties of those geometries will be our mainstay starting next week. Okay.